Well, now we have a very interesting topic which is coming up. And this is about big picture investing. And to present this, I call upon Mr. Harish Krishnan on stage. And to felicitate him, can I have Mr. Jay Kumar, please? Mr. Harish Krishnan, Senior Fund Manager, Kotak Equity Fund. Can I request Mr. Jay Kumar to kindly come on stage? Harish has a decade of experience spread over equity research and fund management. Well, a big round of applause. He is currently managing Kotak 50, Kotak Infrastructure and Economic Reform Fund and Kotak Classic Equity. He has also worked at Infosys Technologies in his earlier stint. Harish is a Bachelor of Technology from Government College of Engineering, Trichur, a postgraduate in management from Indian Institute of Management, Kozhikode. And on a personal front, he loves to travel, and he loves to read, and he is a technology freak. So we are all excited to know about big picture investing. Over to you, please.
Thank you so much. It's indeed an opportunity and a massive pleasure for Kotak and myself to come here and address IFA Galaxy's event. This feels like a TED event, 15 minutes, so much of knowledge being crammed into one day. And I thought, 15 minutes is too short a time, but it's also a reasonable amount of time to take five simple ideas, right? So the idea of my presentation today, which is on big picture investing, is just to reinforce five simple ideas about equity markets in India. Some of these facts might be shocking. Some of these facts hopefully will enlighten you. And the idea is to take facts from across the world, because it's my genuine belief that across the world, everybody has the same aspiration. Everybody wants their children to have a better life than what they currently have. And the journey that a lot of other nations have taken, if we also start moving in those directions, we can be a whole way much different. So let's start out with the first simple idea. Okay. So I know it's a long, it's a big audience. I didn't expect such a huge audience. But bear with me when I take 2 minutes to explain this chart. Okay. And see, essentially, if you look at it, currently in India, we are a $2 trillion economy. I'm talking in trillion dollars because it's easier to understand, right? Now, the first $1 trillion, it took us about 58 years to get there, okay? The next $1 trillion has taken about 7 years to get there. Now, think of what we are going through at this current point of time. In the next 9-10 years, depending on the current growth rate that we are talking about, we are going to create an economy as large as what we currently have created after all these 67 years. Okay, this really is what being in India at this point in time is all about. The fact that what we've created so long, for about 60, 65 odd years, we can create it in the next 10 years. And this, you can see it in your clients' monies, right? Or in your own lifestyle and in your own income. How you've seen they going up in the last 5, 10 years or 15 years or so. So let's look at some examples, right? So if you look at small products, we all know Colgate. This is a brand that my grandfather used, my father used, I use, hopefully my grandchildren will use. Multi-generational brand, right? In 2008, Colgate had a revenue of about 1,500-1,600 crores. Yep. In 2015, that revenue is close to about 4,000 crores. Okay, so try to think of what we are talking about. Look at MRF. Okay, the revenues, and these are all day-to-day products that we all see and read and consume. Okay, in 2008, MRF had a sale of about 6,000 odd crores. Today, they've got a sale of about 15,000 crores. In the last 7-8 years, the economy has doubled. Yeah, companies which can execute well on this opportunity have also seen the revenues grow up anywhere between 2-2.5-3 times, right? And what we are saying is, in the next 8-10-12 years, what are we, there will be some hiccups in growth when we are talking about 8-10 years, but we are talking about the size of what Colgate is today to be replicated in the next 8-10 years. What has taken it maybe 100 years to get there. Okay. Now, this is again something I want you to think about. These are all companies, you know, which are titans in their world. And all of them, mind you, Apple, ExxonMobil, PetroChina, and our own HDFC Bank, are all, you know, for example, Apple, ExxonMobil, and PetroChina were the world's largest companies by market cap at one point of time. Apple still is. PetroChina was in 2007, ExxonMobil was in 2008, 2009, okay? And look at their market caps, you know. We are a fraction at HDFC Bank, what they all are, okay? But if you look at the rate of growth or the percentage returns, our HDFC Bank, not doing anything major, there's no cutting-edge research, there's no cutting-edge engineering like what Apple is doing, yeah? They have managed to grow the fastest. The limited point I'm trying to make is, we are in a phase of time where the opportunity is huge. You need to partner with managements who can see through that opportunity. And if you can do that, India is a wonderful place to be in. Okay. Now let's look at the second trend, or the second simple idea, okay, which is about asset allocation. Now, this is coming from a very, very scholarly work by a gentleman called Thomas Piketty, Capital in the 21st Century, right? Now, forget the chart because it's very long. I'll try and explain what I'm talking about. There's a simple ratio called wealth to income, okay? What is wealth to income? Let's take your client's case, okay? If he has an income of, say, 10 lakhs, in a developed world, like in US, Germany, etc., typical ratio is that he will have a wealth of about 50 lakhs, right? So for 10 lakh of income on an every year basis, his wealth will be 50 lakhs. And that 50 lakhs will be in bonds, it will be in equities, it will be in real estate, gold, etc. Okay? In the developed world, I said that ratio is 5. In the case of India, in our belief, it is anywhere between 2 to 2.5. Okay? So we are currently at, like I said, $2 trillion economy. Okay? As per our estimates, the wealth in India is close to about $6 trillion. Okay? How is that $6 trillion broken down into? You've got agricultural land, which is close to about $1 trillion. All your farming, all those lands that is owned in the rural side. You've got urban land, and urban land accounts for only 4% of India. Okay? It's just 4% of overall India. That accounts for close to about $2.5 trillion. We've got gold, which is worth $1 trillion. No other economy in the world will have gold even at a fraction of what we have. You've got deposits, which include your debt products as well as bank deposits, etc., which is close to about $1 trillion. You've got insurance, PF, all the various other financial products at $500 billion or $500 billion. And you've got equities at $150 to $200 billion. And we've been in this entire afternoon, starting from Prashant Jain to other speakers, telling us that, you know, equities is only 2 to 3%. Nothing new in what we are saying. But look at how the rest of the world has changed. I said the rest of the world was 5, right? There was a point in time when they were also at 2 and 3. And the key is, while of course their economies grew, their income started growing, and therefore their savings went more. But a big change was asset allocation. Sorry. Okay, let's take the case of US. Okay. In 1984, okay, equity and retirement, or basically equity allocation, was about 7%. In 2011, basically 25 years, basically a generation of change, equity and retirement is now 46%. Okay. So the limited point we are saying is, across the world people have similar goals, but the way people have chosen in the West is very different from the way we've chosen ourselves. And therefore, we can either choose to be a part of that trend much earlier on, or we can catch on 10, 15 years. And I'm sure as advisors, you all know this, and you're constantly getting more and more clients into the equity side. Okay, quickly, few statistics on timing the markets, right? A lot of people constantly keep saying, and I'm sure, like Mr. Professor Bakshi said before, we have an overdose of information. A lot of information coming through. We read Economic Times, we see news channels. But and therefore we have clients who constantly keep asking. And the best part of market corrections is the moment market corrects, all clients become technical analysts, right? They'll say no, Nifty will go to 7825.25 and then it will reverse. You will have all these various kinds of figures being thrown around. Let's take the looks of actual facts on Sensex. Okay. Sensex has given a total return, as you all know, anywhere between 15-17%. Between these two dates, it has gone up 29 times. So if you had invested X amount, it has gone up 29 times. Okay. Now, if you were to dissect each of these days of trading, there are 21 days when Sensex hit a 6. That is, went up more than 6%. Recently, we saw a day when markets went down by 6%, but the 6% up day we haven't seen in quite some time to come, right? There are 90 days when markets have gone for a 4, okay? But this is the interesting thing. Now, out of this 5,800 odd days from 91 to 2015, if you had not chosen to be invested in 53 out of those days when there were 6s and 4s, okay, just 53 days, instead of getting 29 times that compounding, your total return would have been 0. Now, of course, clients are smart, right? They say that, why don't you advise me to remain only on those 53 days? So that the rest of the days I can be doing whatever I want to do. The matter of fact is very simple. Nobody will be able to tell you which those 53 days are. So the time in the market is far, far, far more important than timing the market. Yeah. This is more something, that applies to us as well. You know, we make money. Equities as an asset class make money because we invest in companies. We are shareholders in companies. And when they execute, like I said, Colgate has executed, MRF has executed over the last 5, 10, 15, 20 years, their profits grow, and that is how we make money. But, you know, it's very easy for any analyst or for any fund manager to say that equities will give 15% return or EPS will grow by 16-17%. And every year, you know, there are people who come and say, sir, you said 17%, nothing came. It was 8%, and this is happening. The matter of fact is we have to be humble and recognize that businesses don't operate in Excel sheets. It would have been very nice if they were operating in Excel sheets, but they operate in the real world. So let's look at some more data. Okay, I'm just going to read through because it's not, I'm sure the audience there won't get. So we did an exercise of a 20-year study. Okay, it's not a small duration, it's a 20-year study. And we looked at 1,000 plus companies which are not financials. Financials typically tend to be volatile with respect to the economy. But out of 1,000 companies, we said that how many companies outperform the nominal GDP? Nominal GDP is 14% rate over the last 20 years. Okay? How many companies grew at least more than 14% over the last 20 years? It's not a very big number or a tall ask that we are talking about, right? The answer was about 27%, 290 companies. That's a big enough pool set to pick and choose from companies, right? That's nice. Now comes the interesting question. Out of these companies, how many companies actually manage to grow ahead of their nominal GDP each and every year? Any guesses? Just one company. Okay, it's astonishing even when I see the data, because obviously this is not something that you get to see every day. I relax the filter and I say, okay, out of these 20 years, let's say even 15 years they have outperformed, there are only 37 companies. The limited point is not to frighten you of saying that, you know, India is not growing. Markets have given a 15-16% return despite all of this. The point is consistency is very difficult. Okay, no company can continue to keep doing it and keep giving a guidance and outperforming it. We have to remain to be humble and accept that volatility is a norm. Okay. Any guesses on which is the world's longest bull market? Okay, for interest of time, I'll kind of speed it up. It's gone up from 2 to 700 crores. Okay, now it might be easier. It's taken 5,775 years or 288 generations. We're talking about population. Okay, if you believe Adam and Eve's story and they did what they did that many years ago, okay, and that's the longest bull market. I didn't say the most exciting bull market, or maybe that is the most exciting, whatever be it. But we're talking about the longest bull market, right? And that is the human evolution or the human population. Now, any guesses on CAGR? Okay. Sorry? Oh, no, sir. I see the options. It's sliding down. Okay. The answer is 0.03%. Obviously, we are talking of a huge amount of time. Okay. None of us have the luxury of living so many years. Few of you might be advisors who advise clients on estate planning and maybe 2-3 generations. But the limited point I'm making is, time is the biggest weapon in your arsenal to compound wealth. Fund selection, asset allocation is secondary. Time is the biggest. If you start young, okay, you will get that. Okay, so very quickly, you know, we spoke about 5 ideas. Okay, I'll just maybe take you through my disclaimer. Okay, obviously it's a joke, so that hopefully it can lighten up the mood. Yeah, so I'm just going to read it out. Once all villagers decided to pray for rain, on the day of the prayer, all the people gathered, but only one boy came with an umbrella. That's faith. Okay, there will be moments in your career where you need to have faith in certain things. The Indian economy, the Indian political system, the democracy, etc. Those are things that will kind of test you every now and then. That is faith, right? When you throw a baby in the air, she laughs because she knows you'll catch her. That's trust. Yeah, you need to have some pillars of trust. Maybe in RBI, we'll love if Kotak is one such pillar of trust when you're going through difficult times. Every night we go to bed without any assurance of being alive the next morning, but we still set the alarms to wake up. That's hope. Equity markets is all about hope. We need to have a belief that tomorrow will be a better future. And that is the only way in which we can sustain ourselves as a race. Okay? We plan big things for tomorrow in spite of limited knowledge of the future. That's confidence. But we see the world suffering, still we get married. That's overconfidence. So there will be points of time when, you know, your clients will be on one extreme or the other extreme. And it's our job as industry participants and the ecosystem to ensure that we are always grounded and being middled. Thank you for your time. You've been a wonderful audience. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And I'll request you to stay back because I'm inviting Mr. Venkateshwaran to kindly come on stage and present a memento to Mr. Harish Krishnan. If you could occupy the center stage, we all can have a look. Can we all give a big round of applause, please? And for all the men who cheered the last point, I want to hear all of you cheering loud.